Hi, I'm Elizabeth Hendrickson. My company is Curious Duck Digital Laboratory. I'm a consultant, and I help software development leaders improve collaboration, decision-making, and execution. Today, we're going to explore, why does software development take so long? I can already hear some of you saying, what do you mean so long, and compared to what? But hear me out. Right now, at this very minute, somewhere, there's a meeting happening that sounds kind of like this.
Where are we with the release?
We have one more big feature to go, but we don't know what other bugs we'll find. I should know more next week.
You can't not know when you'll ship. I need a commitment that your team will ship by the deadline.
Remember how we rushed to finish the new integrations for the Galactic Hamsters contract?
What's your point?
We're building on a shaky base. Every time we turn around, we find new bugs.
Speaking of bugs, I have some pretty unhappy customers waiting on bug fixes that are supposed to be in this release. Are they fixed yet?
We have to pull those tickets into the release plan.
Hey team, I'm glad I found you. Yak Dynamics is asking me for an update on the ship date. We need the sale this quarter. We're on track to ship at the end of this month, right?
No, that was never the plan.
Yes, it was. That's the date we committed.
You might have committed that date, but I didn't. If we rush this release out the door, we're going to have even more unhappy customers.
Why does your group always take so long to get anything done? You have to fix your productivity problem.
I've been in those meetings. I've been the one presenting charts and graphs with circles and arrows that show estimates versus actuals. I've tried to explain why things are the way they are. None of my explanations have ever made my stakeholders any happier about schedule slips or honestly any more understanding. So what I really wanted was a way to show them how every decision that we made up until that point led to the current situation. So I built a simulation. I introduced the simulation in the last video. The engine has a notion of teams and individuals and work to be done. With every clock tick in the simulation engine, the team members work on their work in progress, deliver that work to the done column, or pick up new work from the backlog. Now let's look at how the simulation models quality, risk, and customer satisfaction. Developers write code. That code gets deployed. The deployment is modeled as a two-dimensional grid. You can think of each cell kind of like a line of code. When new code is deployed, there's a chance that it will surface a defect. Code has a reliability score. That score depends on a number of factors, but the lower the reliability, the higher the probability a defect will show up. If developers are rushing, they write less reliable code. So what happens if there is a defect in the code? When a user uses the system, they choose a pair of arbitrary start and stop points on the two-dimensional grid, then follow a path from start to end. If they can navigate their path entirely on working code, the blue dots, they have a good experience. Their satisfaction goes up, and their path shows in green. If the user encounters a defect or missing code, they have a bad experience. Their satisfaction goes down, and their path shows in red. When a user has a bad experience, they can report a bug. Notice that there is a connection between defects in the code base and bug reports, but it's not a one-to-one relationship. If the user never stumbles on a defect, even if it exists in the deployment, there won't be any bug reports. And the same underlying defect can cause multiple bug reports. This is exactly like in real life. But unlike in real life, everything in the simulation is just a number. So we can actually count the number of defects in a deployment, even if no user has ever found those defects. And we can see the reliability score for the code base, so we know how likely it is that a defect will crop up. Now that you understand how the simulation works, let's use it to model a situation I found myself in 25 years or so ago. This story takes place at a startup in Silicon Valley in the late 1990s, where I was hired to head up a newly formed independent QA group. When I got there, the code quality was pretty solid. We'll represent that in the simulation with the reliability slider. The programmers were under increasing pressure to deliver new features. We'll represent that by adjusting the pressure slider. And the theory was that this QA group, we'd find bugs and then they would be prioritized after code freeze at the end of the release. So as we began this first release after I was hired, well, it went more or less the way we all expected. While the programmers started coding the new features, the testers wrote test plans. Once the programmers started delivering builds to QA, we started testing. We found bugs, and the programmers fixed the bugs, and we shipped in a reasonable time frame. Now, we knew that pressure was increasing. What we didn't really fully understand was that the system reliability, the code base, it was getting shakier. Now, as we went into this next release, we were expecting it to go pretty much like the last one had, and at first everything seemed pretty normal. This time around, QA was finding even more bugs, and at the time we thought, woohoo, we're doing a great job of testing this thing. And yes, we were doing more better testing. But we were also operating in a target-rich environment. There were more bugs to be found. Eventually, we shipped after substantial delays, and the executive team was quite frankly very frustrated with engineering. So with the next release, they put even more pressure on engineering. Well, frankly, on all of us to deliver. And of course, the code base was getting shakier and shakier. So we went into that next release, and it became apparent fairly quickly that we had a little bit of a disaster on our hands. The code base had hit a tipping point. Every change had a high probability of introducing a new defect. For a while, it seemed like the schedule slipped 2 days for every day we worked because the bug backlog was growing so fast. We held bug triage meetings, so many bug triage meetings, to debate which bugs really had to be fixed before the release. In the end, when we did ship, it was less because we thought we were ready and more because we had a could-not-miss customer deadline. There's an old joke that software isn't released, it escapes. That was us. The product was riddled with defects. Customers were quite displeased. And the customer with that can't-miss deadline decided not to move forward with our product. Unfortunately, the executive team's response to the situation was to put even more pressure on all of us. So you can imagine how that went. I wish I could tell you that this is a story of redemption with a happy ending. It's not. The company was dead less than a year after we shipped that terrible release. And the company's demise was as much because we hadn't found product market fit as our quality problems, but the quality problems quite certainly got in the way of finding product market fit. If you've read my paper, Better Testing, Worse Quality, this is one of the experiences that inspired it. So what can we learn from this? First, when the code base becomes fragile, there will be late-breaking surprises that cause schedule delays. So when a leader is upset about schedule slips, it's worth noting that it's very likely that decisions made a while ago are catching up to the team now. Second, if the code base is in a fragile state, putting pressure on developers to deliver faster is the absolute worst thing you can do, because it will lead to the code base becoming more fragile. And of course, if the software goes out with defects, there will be a business impact, and probably support escalations that interrupt work on the next release. But that's a topic for another video. Here's the thing about time pressure. When I hear a leader asking for commitment or pushing deadlines, what I really hear is a plea for something that we all want, predictability. But the only way to get predictable timelines is to have a code base that behaves predictably with each change. Focusing on deadlines, focusing on time, creates pressure. Pressure results in worse software because developers feel like they have to take shortcuts. Maybe they test less, or maybe they slam some code in where it doesn't really belong, but it's much easier to put in. And that worse software, that creates risk. That leads to late-breaking surprises and schedule slips. So as counterintuitive as it seems, focusing on time makes releases take longer. The ultimate lesson here is if you want predictable schedules, push on the underlying causes of unpredictable software behavior rather than on adherence to a schedule. It turns out there are two very simple things that make a huge difference. They're very hard to do, but they're very simple to explain. One is to deal with bug reports right away. Put them at the top of the backlog, not at the end of the release after code freeze. And the second is to give the team the time and space to make things better. So how does that play out in the simulation? Let's run the same scenario as that last disastrous release, but this time we'll fix bugs as soon as they're found. Note that it does take longer to get to feature complete, so it might feel like things are getting slower, and that can cause leaders to become impatient. But the code base is more reliable, and there are fewer defects. If we lower the pressure on developers even more, giving developers the time and space to prevent issues from getting into the code base, the schedules become even more predictable. Of course, the simulation is only a model, but despite the inherent randomness in the way that defects are generated, the simulation consistently shows that prioritizing bugs first and making time to increase reliability results in faster and more predictable release schedules. I hope this has given you insight into some of the system dynamics at play in software development. And if you have ideas for situations you'd like to see modeled with the Curious Duck simulation, please reach out. Thank you so much for watching.